One way is surgery. Yeah? Me being orthodox, I would say surgery is the last thing that I will ever go for. I don't say no. Worst case scenario, surgery, yes. But if I can manage, I give my dog a good 15 years by doing alternative therapies, then why not? Why not? Yeah? So coming down to your cruciate injuries, your hip dysplasia, elbow dysplasia, your teleluxation. You all know what hip dysplasia, elbow dysplasia is, right? You know how painful that can be. So how does hydrotherapy really work? So we get a dog that is basically, I get a call, I have a dog with a chronic hip dysplasia.
Muscle wastage. I knew that was going to happen when they were basically vet has to sign off that the dog is physically fit to swim. That means if there is a heart condition, I'm supposed to be named a vet. Because what I will push a Dobby, I will not push my dog who's a Bobo. Because my Bobo has arrhythmia. He'll go blue in the water. Completely. And anyway, he doesn't need to do anything. He'll just be in the water, and just the hydrostatic pressure of the water will make him go blue. So that is why I need to be aware of what medical conditions the dogs are coming with. That's why the vets come into play. So initially when I actually came up with this concept here, nobody took me seriously. I was just like, how can he get it? Whatever. I had only very few vets who basically supported this idea and kind of worked with me. And now I have most of the vets working with me. And it's been a process. And I think every new thing that comes in is always a process. I have seen paraplegic dogs start walking. Maybe not completely, but at least I go to the whole satisfaction factory pain. When I see a wobble, it's okay. Now I know what I'm doing is correct. Yeah, so like I was saying, we're talking about what are your sign-offs. One is your vet reference. Second is your vaccination. The dogs are doing the heat. Now, you think cool, it's big, we can't flush. We can't flush heat everywhere. So, the dogs need to be vaccination. If they have any form of vaccines, lacerations, skin infections, or infection, they can't. Because it's just going to be minus. So, like common sense. And common sense is what you look at. And at that point, if I'm interested, let the hydrotherapist know that, okay, my pet has this. So, we're not coming into possession. So, that's that. The other thing we do is, like I said, heat. Very important. That is something that we need. And your nutrition. Because you have hair. You deal with hair. And you deal with fine particle hair. So, filtration. That is the most important things coming down to when you plan to open a hydrotherapy session. And I would say, let the pool be small. Get the best filtration system. That is absolutely very, very necessary. Because you're going to be in the water. Yeah? So, you have to basically safeguard yourself also. Secondly, you need to basically make sure. Outdoor pools, you have your limitations. You can't swim in this weather outside. Firstly, you will have a sunstroke. And as we all know, sunstroke is the biggest killer for dogs. So, even if they are in water, they're exercising. That means their body is heating up. That means their head is heating up. It has to be a cool environment that they come into. So, setups where hydrotherapy sessions, a pool setup is concerned, preferably indoors. Yeah, however big you want to go, however small you want to go, it is, you should basically think about it is like, I stand 5 feet, 5.5 inches. Yeah? The water is actually for me at 3 feet. That's the only way I can walk in the water. The minute it becomes 3.5 feet, I will not be able to walk. That means I will not be able to swim, and then I have to move on. That means I'm 5 hours in the pool, I am, I'm 5 hours. So you have to look at these things as common sense when we're setting up. You want to show them the video? I had two FHO cases that had come to me. One is